In this video, we're going to be looking at the incredible life story of Tina Turner. Known for her raspy rock voice, big hair, and an even bigger personality, Tina Turner has been an icon of music for the last 50 years. But it hasn't all been smooth sailing for Tina. In fact, she's experienced some terrible, unspeakable lows, things that most people probably wouldn't be able to bounce back from. Stay tuned for her jaw-dropping story. Born in November 1939, Tina, or should I say Annie Mae, because that was her birth name, was the unwanted child of Zelma Priscilla and Floyd Richard Bullock. Writing in her autobiography, Ike Turner, she stated that she felt her mother didn't love her and made no secret of the fact that she was an unplanned and unwanted baby. The truth was, her mother had planned to leave her father when pregnant with her, but failed to go through with the plan at the time, and Tina felt that she was always resented by her mother as a result. She was a very young woman who didn't want another kid, Turner wrote. Years later, her mum would indeed run away and leave the family, but for most of her early childhood, the family moved from state to state across the country, and often, young Annie Mae and her sister would be separated from their parents and sent to live for long periods of time with their grandparents. Her grandmother, a Baptist, would raise her with strict values and was quite the disciplinarian, beating Annie Mae for any misbehaviour. The only joy she experienced at the time was when she could sing in the Baptist church choir and perform in local talent shows. When Annie Mae left school, she started working as a nurse, and her dream was to go into that profession full time. But, as fate would have it, one night barely out of high school, her elder sister Aline took her to the St. Louis Club Imperial, where she would meet the singer of the band performing that night, Ike Turner. This chance encounter would change her life forever. From a professional standpoint, soon after meeting, Ike would ask Tina to fill in on his single titled A Fool for Love when the original singer didn't turn up, and the rest, as you can say, is history. And from a personal standpoint, Annie Mae would also enter into a short-lived relationship with the saxophone player in the band, Raymond Hill, and in under a year would give birth to her first child, Craig. She was just 18 years old at the time. Raymond and Annie Mae's relationship wouldn't last long, and when they eventually separated, Annie Mae had grown to be so important to the band that the other band members took her side and beat up Raymond so badly that he ended up with a broken leg. Raymond left the band and would never perform with them again. In no time at all after the separation with Raymond, Annie Mae found herself in a relationship with the star of the band, Ike Turner. Ike was married at the time, and Tina, years later, revealed that when she first met him, she thought, quote, he was terribly ugly. But nonetheless, a romantic relationship blossomed, and Ike eventually left his wife to be with Annie Mae. Ike's two children from his ex-wife would also be adopted and raised by her. This meant Annie Mae was both working for Ike as a singer in his band and was also in a relationship with him too, and the power dynamic within the relationship, coupled with the 7-year age difference between the pair, meant that Ike was able to wield significant control over Annie Mae. In 1959, when she was aged 20, Ike forced Annie Mae Bullock to change her name to Tina Turner. He felt the name Annie Mae wasn't memorable enough, and he'd also had singers in the past stop working with him once they'd found fame, so he was determined to do all he could to keep Tina linked to him. By legally trademarking and copyrighting the performer's new name, Ike ensured that he could keep control of the music rights and performance royalties because, in the eyes of the law, the Tina Turner brand was his creation and wouldn't have existed without him.
If I ran away, Tina was his name. It was patent, as you call it. So
he could own you.
So he could own me. Are you smart?
The pair officially got married in 1962 in Tijuana, Mexico. And sadly, the writing was on the wall from the very beginning. For example, on their wedding night, Tina revealed that Ike took her to an explicit adult show. People can't imagine the kind of man he was. A man who takes his brand new wife to a place like that right after their marriage ceremony, she said. Ike was a drug addict and an incredibly controlling man who would physically and emotionally abuse Tina, as well as openly cheat on her too. Recounting some of the worst experiences, Tina states, "He threw hot coffee in my face, giving me third-degree burns. He used my nose as a punching bag so many times that I could taste blood running down my throat as I sang. He broke my jaw, and I couldn't remember what it was like to not have a black eye. The people closest to us saw what was happening, but they couldn't stop him. any attempt to help me would make him more violent. And while the temptation might be for people to say, why didn't she just leave him? We've got to remember just how vulnerable Tina Turner was at this stage. She'd grown up in an unloving family. She'd been abandoned by her own mother. She'd witnessed firsthand abuse in her parents' relationship. She was now a mum of four, two of her own and two adopted, and she found herself trapped in a professional and personal relationship that was reliant upon one man, Ike Turner. And all of this before the age of 21. Of the situation she found herself in, Tina says, there was nothing else to do. When I met Ike, I had nowhere else to go. I had no money and didn't know how to take the first step. And while from a musical standpoint, their partnership was going from strength to strength, having a string of top 10 hits including titles such as River Deep Mountain High, I Idolize You, and Poor Fool, even winning a Grammy for their cover of the song Proud Mary, from a personal standpoint, Tina was having to endure physical and emotional hell for years at Ike's hands, even forcing her to take to the stage and sing after being battered. In 1968, this all culminated in Tina attempting to commit suicide. She went to the doctor, claimed she had trouble sleeping so he would prescribe sleeping pills, and then she went ahead and took 50 in one go. This wasn't a cry for help. This was Tina trying to end her suffering. Her exact words were, I convinced myself that death was my only way out. And while thankfully the attempt wasn't successful, the overdose proved to be a turning point in her life, as during the course of her recovery, she became aware of her own mental strength and the fact that she could survive without Ike. Towards the end of their relationship, their lives had started to take very different paths. Ike was becoming more and more involved with drugs, while Tina had found some relief by converting to Buddhism, chanting up to 3 hours a day. Eventually, Tina decided that enough was enough, and she left Ike following yet another fight in a limousine, in which he beat her and left her bloodied. This happened while on their way to the Hilton Hotel in Dallas on July the 1st, 1976, and it was the last straw for Tina, who fled to a nearby Ramada Inn hotel with just 36 cents in her pocket and a mobile credit card. She then hid in friends' houses to ensure that Ike couldn't find her. After leaving him, many promoters tried to sue Tina personally to recoup ticket sales. Ike also would send round his henchmen to intimidate her, one night even shooting bullets into the house that she had relocated to. She would get so scared that on some nights she would sleep in a closet. Eventually, after 2 years of battling in the courts, their divorce would become official, and it was finalised on March the 29th, 1978. In the settlement, Tina gave Ike her share of their recording studio, publishing companies, real estate, and he kept his 4 cars. Tina retained her songwriter royalties from songs that she'd written, but Ike received the publishing royalties for his compositions and hers. The courts ruled that she could keep her 2 Jaguar cars, furs, jewellery, and most importantly, they ruled in her favour that she could keep the Tina Turner stage name, which was a huge point of contention, with Ike arguing that he owned the trademark himself. As part of the negotiations, Tina also took full responsibility for all the debts incurred from their missed concert dates, because all of the tour dates had been sold, but the concerts hadn't taken place. All said and done, Tina was left greatly out of pocket, but she was free to start again with her stage name. In the 2 years prior to her divorce, Tina released 2 solo albums, Tina Turns the Country On and Acid Queen, but the pair completely flopped, and it was considered by many at the time that this was the beginning of the end for the singer. Many considered Tina's success to be down to Ike. What most people didn't realise was that Tina was a powerhouse in her own right. One of the few people who realised Tina's solo potential was the legendary record producer Phil Spector, who back in 1965 actually paid Ike $20,000 to stay away from the studio while Tina was recording her song River Deep Mountain High. Although the record was credited to both Ike and Tina, Phil knew just how controlling Ike was, so wanted him well away from the studio while Tina was working on the song. Sadly, the song didn't do too well in the States, but it did reach number 3 in the UK, which resulted in Tina being given the opportunity to open for Mick Jagger and the Rolling Stones during their UK tour. But again, this still wasn't enough for her critics. Following her divorce, her critics were very vocal in pointing out that Tina hadn't had any number one hits in the USA, and her biggest claim to fame was opening for the Rolling Stones on their UK tour, which was impressive, but it was still just an opening act, not a main event. That's where David Bowie let the cat out of the bag. At the time, David Bowie was one of the hottest musicians in the world. In the early 1980s, David was in New York, set to have a meeting with the record label EMI, when he postponed the meeting so that he could, quote, see his favourite singer Tina Turner. This created a stampede for her attention. The relatively unknown Tina Turner, who up until that point had had relatively muted success, suddenly had one of the most famous pop stars in the world coming out as her biggest fan. With this sudden attention, Tina would go on to sign for Capitol EMI Records. When someone has an esteemed career as much as Tina's, it's obvious that she's going to have records to her name, from stage appearances to venues covered and even records sold. But Tina has a list of record achievements that are noteworthy for many reasons. In 1988, Tina got the Guinness World Record for performing to the largest paid audience for the Maracanã in Rio de Janeiro, Brazil, setting the stage alight to 184,000 adoring fans, the largest audience for a female solo artist at the time. In the UK, Tina was the first female artist to have a top 40 hit in 6 consecutive decades and has sold over 200 million records worldwide. Her hit single, What's Love Got to Do with It, was voted number 38 in the Rolling Stones magazine 500 Greatest Songs of All Time, and somewhat controversially, Rolling Stone magazine also voted Tina and Ike number 2 on their list of the 20 greatest duos of all time. And even her legendary title track Private Dancer from the album by the same name had an interesting story. It was initially written to be sung by the rock band Dire Straits, but when Tina heard it, she claimed the song sounded too butch, so she tried a toned down version herself. Record executives at Capitol EMI loved it, and the album went on to have critical success, selling 10 million copies, scoring her her first number one hit, and winning 3 Grammys, a record at the time for a debut album. To this day, years after her last release, Tina still holds the record for the most Grammy wins for the best female rock performance, with 4 gramophone statuettes to her name. In the wake of her divorce, Tina embarked on a creative and commercial resurgence, re-emerging in the 1980s with signature hits including Let's Stay Together, Private Dancer, and Simply the Best. But in her private life, she still felt loneliness and sought male companionship, even after the terrible experiences that she'd had with Ike all those years earlier. That is until she met Erwin Bach, a German record producer who is 17 years her junior. Erwin and Tina first met at a record label party in London in 1985. When Tina was on tour in Europe in the late 1980s, Erwin surprised her at the airport with a huge sign with her name on it, and love blossomed from there. Erwin was completely in love and besotted with the superstar, and for her part, Tina felt the same way for him too. When they finally got married in 2013, after 27 years of dating, the stars threw a lavish ceremony that had celebrity friends, family and guests turn up in white, whilst the Queen of Rock strutted her stuff all in black. Tina also gave up her US citizenship and completely uprooted from the States to join Erwin in Switzerland, where he's the head of the record label EMI Switzerland. Sadly, since marriage, Tina has had a series of health complications. Just 3 weeks after her wedding, she suffered a stroke and had to learn how to walk again. 3 years after the stroke, in 2016, she was diagnosed with intestinal cancer. She turned down standard treatments in favour of homeopathic remedies, and this was a bad choice, as eventually she would suffer total kidney failure. Switzerland is a nation that has one of the lowest organ donation rates, and the singer was beginning to lose hope that a donor would ever be found. That is, until Erwin stepped in. In her autobiography, Tina said, "If my kidneys were going and it was time for me to die, I could accept that. It was okay. When it's time, it's really time." Thankfully, this was not Tina's time. Erwin gave her the ultimate gift, one of his own kidneys, and despite worries that the kidney would be rejected by Tina's body, the transplant went ahead successfully. Tina went on to add, "The best moment was when Erwin came rolling into my room in his wheelchair. He somehow still managed to look good, even handsome, as he greeted me with an energetic, 'Hi, darling.'" With that said, Tina does still suffer from a host of medical complications, and she says, "I know that my medical adventure is far from over. There's always another test, another doctor's appointment, a biopsy to get through. We're both still here, closer than we ever imagined, and that's cause for celebration." Having sung from her 20s right up until 70 years old, today Tina no longer performs. Her last tour was in 2009 on her 50th anniversary, and the tour was a commercial success, estimated to have grossed $130 million. After that, she retired for good. "I don't sing, I don't dance, I don't dress up," she said. "I was just tired of singing and making everyone happy. That's all I'd ever done in my life. I had a terrible life, but I just kept going. You just keep going and you hope that something will come. This came. If you get up and leave, if you rise from the ashes, life will open up for you again." And we couldn't be happier for Tina. She deserves all the nice things and the peaceful life she's now living. Her life story has been portrayed on film and on the stage, including the 1993 film What's Love Got to Do with It and the Tina Turner musical, which opened its doors in London in 2017, but now performs in Holland, Germany, and of course Broadway. If you enjoyed this video, you'll love our Dolly Parton video too. Did you know that Tina Turner and Dolly Parton were both born in Tennessee? There must be something in the water over there. If you haven't seen our video about Dolly Parton and her incredible rags to riches story, check that out here. Thanks for watching, and remember, click on that subscribe button to stay up to date with our latest videos and to show your support for our channel. Thanks for watching, catch you on the next video.